So right now we're going to present our assignment question. So the title is The Impact of FinTech in Malaysia's Development. So these are our group members, and I'm Siubin. Okay, so I'm going to present our introduction first. So what is FinTech? FinTech is a line of business based on using technology to provide financial services. Financial technology companies are generally startups founded with the purpose of disrupting current financial systems and corporations that rely less on technology. In 2015 and the first half of 2016, $345 million, representing 11% of total venture capital funding in Southeast Asia went into the fintech industry. So globally, it is estimated that the value of fintech investment will amount to about $40 million by year 2020. So in Malaysia, the presence of fintech is still new, but it's growing rapidly. Okay, so our bank regarding governance, Dr. Muhammad Ibrahim has also reminded that banks of the trade post like FinTech, citing a report by McKinsey, stating that 10% to 40% of banking revenue is possibly at risk by 2025 due to innovations outside banking institutions. While Malaysian banks are quick to point out that FinTech disrupts businesses, they are embracing the move either by coming up with their own FinTech innovations or working with the FinTech startups. One of the growing areas in FinTech is peer-to-peer, or we call it P2P lending. It is actually an online platform which helps to match borrowers with lenders by bypassing the banks. FinTech transactions in the country this year total a mere of $6.37 million compared with the global figure of $769.3 million. So however, this figure is expected to rise as more startups produce various innovations and enter the Malaysian capital market. Okay, next, these are the literature review by Muhammad B. Ibrahim and from PwC Publications and from Amir Ahmad Basir. Okay, so the problem statement. So what are we trying to investigate in this assignment is that, okay, how does FinTech actually impact on employment, on payment system, on blockchain technology and the regulations of FinTech? Next, I'm going to pass to Jingwen.
Look at methodology. There are three types of methodology I'm using in this report. Firstly, is quantitative research. Analyze the transaction of check and e-payment from year 2012 to 2016 to investigate e-payment usage trend in Malaysia. Secondly, is qualitative research. All of our members attend a FinTech talk organized by iFreestyle.UM, speaker from FDEG, and also found. Through this talk, we can get know more about FinTech. The third one is data collection by using secondary data. Firstly, is official website from Bank Negara and the journal and article that was published as reference comparative and contextual data for this analysis. And last one is statistics that published by government. Now,
we move to the payment system. So, there's been a visible trend for many countries, including Malaysia, that have progressed towards electronic payment to replace cash. So now, we look at the Malaysian retail payment. It's been divided into three: first one, system, instrument, and channel. And in system, we have the National Electronic Check Information Clearing System, which is called eSpeak, which is implemented in 2008. And this thing allowed customers to get the funds from their check deposit the next business day. So other than that, we have SEND, which will share ATM network, interbank, gyro, direct debit and financial process exchange. And for the instrument, we have check, credit card, charge card, debit card, and e-money. E-money is a very major and new thing here, where e-money is a payment instrument that contains monetary value that has been paid in a month by the user. So for the channel, we have internet banking, mobile banking and mobile payment. So now let's look at the evolution of payment system in Malaysia. So in Malaysia, we know that from 1950s to 1990s, mostly payment modes are based on paper. And as a fact, where in 1981, only the ATM machine got introduced to the whole world. So during the 1990s to the 2000s, we can see that in 1990s, where there's an introduction of telephone banking service. And then we can see that during this period, there's an introduction of modern payment service, which is based on network and internet. And for Malaysia, the ATM only came in 1997. So during the 2000s to 2010 period, we can see there's an increase in the number of retail payment service that provide payment channel and varieties of things. And during 2004, Alibaba just created a new thing called Alipay, and it just came into Malaysia a few months ago, which is being approved by both CIMB and Maybank, which allowed the China tourists to make purchases in Malaysia. And for Malaysia, there's a new thing called Samsung Pay, which been launched in end of February, 2 months ago. And this with this Samsung Pay, it's quite safe and secure to say that. Because whenever you make a transaction, you need your fingerprint, and it's impossible to have someone else to have the same fingerprint as yours. So now I'll pass the words to my good friend, Chong Wei Hao.
Woo! Next, I will talk about e-payment usage trends in Malaysia. This graph shows the transition of cheque and e-payments from 2012 to 2016. The green color is the cheque transaction in value, while the red color is cheque transaction in volume. Blue color is e-payments transaction in value, while the purple color is in volume. So, from the graph, it shows that e-payment transaction in volume has increased from 54.4 in 2012, increased to 97.5 in 2016. On the other hand, for check, the transaction in volume, it had decreased from 6.8 in 2012 to 4.2 in 2016. Next. All graphs show the trend of four electronic payment instruments in Malaysia, which are credit card, debit card, charge card, and e-money. So from the graph, in terms of value, credit cards are most widely used in Malaysia, where it increased from 40.9 million to 118.5 million. On the other hand, E-money is a medium used for settlement that uses neither cash nor paper to make purchases. In terms of transaction of volume, e-money is most widely used instrument in Malaysia, while rise from 365.5 to 1,665.5 in 2016. For debit card, the volume and value have increased from 2.1 to 107.5 million and 0.3 to 22.5 million respectively. While for charge card, it has become less popular in recent years, where its volume has decreased from 6.3 billion in 2005 to 4.1 billion in 2016. Next, I will pass to Elizabeth.
I'll be explaining Malaysia FinTech company versus conventional companies. And as we know that FinTech is growing in Malaysia, and there are a lot of new companies coming up, FinTech companies especially. And there are a lot of companies coming out in such sectors where they help us in financial planning, which help us to understand our own needs. And it also simplify advice and guided our sales, which help us to make the correct decision. And besides that, it help us to digitalize and discretionary management, which means we can manage our own investments. So FinTech is coming out with all these companies to help us to ease our life. So now we can see that traditional banking versus fintech company, as even fintech is growing, but we cannot deny that traditional banks still play a role, that fintech companies still cannot replace traditional banks because banks still play an option for us to apply loans, and everyone knows the credibility, so people will still go to banks to apply loans. And as we can see that bank versus this new fintech company, which is called Prime Keeper, is a very upcoming thing, and it's also actually an open bank in Malaysia, which is a digital banking platform designed for people's convenience. and it enables people to link multiple bank accounts. For example, if you have, let's say you have Bank Islam and CIMB account, and you can link them to this platform, and you can actually like pay bills, transfer cash, and reload your prepaid card and touch and go easily through this platform. This is how this is what services that traditional banking cannot provide us compared to the fintech company. And with all this, it definitely lower our transaction costs. So as we can see that how fintech company is going to help us to ease our life is actually reduces costs and improve quality of financial services because it unburdened by regulatory, which means we can lend and borrow and obtain benefit and have better offer from there. As compared to banks, they have fixed rate, which sometimes the rate that we cannot negotiate for it. So, and there are better ways in assessing risk because fintech platform can actually store information, and for us to invest, we actually want to minimize our own risk. So from here, with all the information is stored, we can help us in making more correct analyzation so that we'll get a better result from there. And the third one will be fintech newcomers will create a more diverse and hence stable landscape. Because fintech company, in a banking fintech company, it's not restricted at only a geographical area. People can reach out each other easily. So borrower and saver can actually directly connect to each other. And this will avoid a mismatch of maturities where traditional banking will actually happen, like problems like that will actually happen. And lastly is, from the growth of fintech, we can see that traditional banking is moving towards narrow banking. Narrow banking actually means traditional banks will deposit and hold only safe liquid assets, while what fintech platform will do is match the borrower and saver. So this, which means bank will not play such a big role from here. So when bank did not play such a big role, they will have lower margin, and when they do such a loan, they will charge higher so that to actually protect people that actually borrow the loan. And from here, it will actually cut costs and improve quality services. This is the difficult part for bank to actually cut costs and improve services. And definitely unemployment will happen because with digitalizing, we need less people. And so we'll pass to Yushen.
So first of all, what is blockchain? So blockchain, technically, blockchain is a system of distributed and decentralized ledger. What it basically does is to optimize procedures by allowing businesses to share data in a transparent and secure way among the enterprise and execute commands and orders through blockchain programming. So some of its usage including cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin, smart contracts, asset registries, securities, and record keeping. Okay, so how does blockchain works? Okay, everyone can look at the picture over here. So as an example, in a conventional banking system, how it works is that, let's say I want to transfer the money to another friend. So it needs to go through my bank, which you inform the other bank that I want to transfer a certain amount of money to my friend, then only the transaction will be done and the money will go to my friend. So it's a lengthy process. So we can see it's a lengthy process, it's time consuming. But on the other hand, over here, how blockchain work is that blockchain, again, the keyword is a decentralized ledger. So how blockchain work is that, let's say I want to transfer money to another friend, but how, instead of going through intermediaries such as bank, what I did is I just with a few clicks of keyboards in front of my computer, and I can transfer the money to my friend. But what then you might ask, who will validate the transaction?
is by the blockchain user in the blockchain system. So basically, all these people using in the blockchain environment will verify and validate the transaction. So it is how it works. So basically, in essence, blockchain deny the role of regulator, middleman, and intermediaries. So now I'll be talking a little bit about the development of blockchain in Malaysia. So we can see, according to a survey by PwC Malaysia, what happened is that 41% of Malaysian banking respondents in the FinTech survey are only slightly familiar with blockchain, which means they are actually they don't really know a lot about blockchain. And of these people, 59% of them are unsure about how to respond to the emergence of blockchain. So basically, they have no clue about blockchain. So, but on the other hand, we can see big companies and industries and institutions are already into blockchain. As an example, OCBC Bank has already undergo a pilot payment transaction between OCBC Malaysia and the Bank of Singapore in November 2016. Through a blockchain system, and OCBC Bank has become the first bank in Southeast Asia to execute a transaction through blockchain system. And on the other hand, in Malaysia, a blockchain embassy of Asia, BCE, has also been established to educate organizations throughout Asia in the blockchain technology and is based in Malaysia. So basically, we can see a very big a lot of people still do not aware about blockchain, but on the other hand, big institutions has already going into blockchain system and already utilizing the technology. So now I'll be talking about Bitcoin, which is cryptocurrency. So cryptocurrency is the most successful implementation of blockchain technology. So, but there have been a mixed reaction for cryptocurrency. As we know, Bitcoin, cryptocurrency such as Bitcoin does not really exist in real life, which means we cannot hold the money. It's only a currency which value in a digital wallet. So what happened is there's a mixed reaction between countries on the usage of cryptocurrency such as Bitcoin. So in April 2017, Japan has made Bitcoin legal, a legal currency, and considered this currency as an asset and is taxable, which means Japan recognized Bitcoin. But on the other hand, Indian government has stated that the use of Bitcoin is illegal and it could result in a breach of anti-money laundering law. So we can see there's a mixed reaction between all these big countries. So, however, we must think that Bitcoin was a top performing currency in year 2015 and 2016, outperformed USD and other major currencies in the market. But Bitcoin performed terribly in year 2014 when a Bitcoin theft worth approximately near to $473 million happened to MTGox, which is the largest Bitcoin exchange during that time, and which caused the company to go bankrupt. So we can see this is a table of Bitcoin trend over the years. So we can see in year 2013 it peaked, then it crashed during the theft in 2014. However, due to positive sentiment, strike back up, becoming the most performing currency in year 2014. So now I'll be talking about the potential impact of blockchain technology. So first of all, is obviously the retrenchment in the financial sector, which with the innovations of financial technology, what happened is CIMB Bank in 2015 reduced their workforce up to 11.1%, which is near to 3,600 employees. And what happened is Standard Chartered as well in Singapore and Hong Kong branch let go of 10% of their employees in 2016. So we can see blockchain is disrupting the financial sector. And who and employees of financial sectors are impacted the most. But on the other hand, the other potential impact of blockchain technology is that it streamlines financial services such as insurance. So as an example, AIA, a very famous insurance provider, has already started to incorporate blockchain solutions in the global financial system. And what another potential usage impact of blockchain technology is that it eliminates intermediaries because due to its nature where it can eliminate potential information asymmetry among companies and policyholders, and hence reducing the roles of insurance agent to convey information, to explain information to the customers. So basically what it means that customers can straight away buy insurance from insurance company without going through insurance agent, and hence insurance agent as an intermediary will be threatened out of their work. So that's all. I'll pass to Siu Hin.
I'm going to talk about the regulatory system in Malaysia. So on 18 October 2016, Bank Negara Malaysia issued a financial technology regulatory sandbox framework. So this sandbox approach is actually aims to enable innovative fintech solutions or services to be deployed and tested in a live or safe environment. So this is meant to facilitate the process of reviewing existing regulatory requirements in order to create a regulatory environment that is conducive for the deployment of fintech. So BNM will actually accord regulatory flexibilities to successful applicants to enable them to test their solutions in a live environment subject to specified parameters and timeframes. Their extent of regulatory flexibility given will be determined on a case-by-case basis. Okay, so the period shall not exceed 12 months, but a written application will be required to extend the testing period. So participants must actually submit interim reports to BNM on the progress of the test and the final report within 30 calendar days from the expiry of the test. Okay, the approval of participate in the sandbox and any regulatory flexibility accorded will automatically expire upon expiry of the testing period. So upon completion of testing, the Bank Negara Malaysia will decide whether to allow the solutions to be introduced to the market or a wider scale. So we can see that introductions of the sandbox should actually be applauded as it demonstrates BNM's acknowledgement of fintech as a catalyst for the development of progressive financial technology.
Talking about way forward, implication of fintech to Malaysia's finance service industry are far-reaching. As traditional player and developing country, due to retool their business culture and process in response to these new wave of disruption. So what? Malaysia should action now and fast because there was no time for us to wait and see. Only 47% of them have placed fintech at the forefront of strategy decision making. Fintech company and bank should increase the awareness of fintech given the personal and sensitive nature of financial information, expand to the consumer, bank and others party about the advantage of fintech. Consumers should change their mindset of using traditional financial stuff. Consumers should always up to the date about financial technology. From will need to also challenge existing assumptions, experience with new business arrangement through partnership and collaboration. This includes embracing new technology in every part of their business, like make transaction, customizing their solution to meet individual needs, focusing on the customer need and experience, and incorporating fintech in the core of their strategy. Next, bank must drive the creation of holistic fintech ecosystem and become the dynamic center of it, creating a robust fintech ecosystem and taking central stage in the digital world. Moreover, for government should have more forum for fintech discussion. Bringing key players in fintech regulation and policy making together is crucial to coming up with solutions that promote the benefit of fintech while preventing against potential harm to consumer business and profit. Now I'll pass to Yixuan for conclusion.
After everything that we have heard, we know that fintech is here and fintech is here to stay, and it will disrupt the financial sector no matter how people try to deny it. So what do we think about fintech is that it is a as the disruptive ideas and innovation emerge in the financial technology in the future, industry players and consumers will need to embrace the rise of FinTech and adapt to this rapidly changing environment. And because without us adapting to this environment, we will be obsolete sooner or later, and we as the employees will sooner or later lose our job, and hence we need to be very, very aware of the rise of FinTech and its development. Thank you so much.